Welcome back to the podcast, Conversations with Jeff Bucknam. Dr. Jeff Bucknam is the lead pastor of vision and teaching at Harvest Bible Chapel in Chicagoland. And I'm your host, Tommy Kreitz, and we are going to have a conversation today. It's a bit of a special edition today. Breaking. Should be great. It's about finance.
Yeah, should be great. So,
yeah, don't tune out now.
Usually you don't tell the people up front that it's about
finance. What the thing is, yeah, it's more, it's like, yeah. Yeah, I forgot. Yeah.
In radio, they have a thing called a tease. And you usually don't tease by saying, next,
all right,
the accountants.
Yeah, yeah. All right, here. Let's start over. Hey everyone, good to see you. Glad you could tune in.
Stick around for some exciting news later.
Yeah, it's going to be incredible, and we're going to give you a little taste of that in our preamble ramble or our pre-ramble. Which, it, by the way, if you're just joining us, welcome. And we have like a little conversation before the conversation about whatever we want to talk about, which can be anything from current events to.
To anything,
finance, you know.
Sometimes we go over the same ground, but we forgot we went over it.
Yeah, yeah. We tread a little bit of the conspiracy theory ground quite a bit, which is okay. You know, praise the Lord.
What do you got today, Tommy?
What are we talking about? So obviously, because we are talking about finance, I thought, man, what an interesting thing to talk to you about Bitcoin and cryptocurrency in general. And just see, like, what's your take on it? Yeah. What do you think? What do you think about cryptocurrency in general?
Yeah.
And in particular, the rise of Bitcoin.
I do have one opinion about this. And I do think it would be a cool thing for us to be in a situation where the government can't just determine all the stuff about the money. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Like anytime they want to just go into further debt, they just print more money and all that. Whereas Bitcoin doesn't really let you do that. So
not a lot of regulations surrounding market.
I'm all about that. Although I can understand why governments are like, you know what? We're going to regulate all of this.
Yeah.
And try to do our own digital currency as fast as we can, because if we don't, we're in trouble. So, but I don't know. I've listened to podcasts where they've tried to explain Bitcoin and the blockchain.
Yeah. And you understood all of it,
no,
right?
No, I don't have a clue. And apparently you can mine the blockchain.
Yeah, and get Bitcoin or Ethereum or any of the others. Yeah.
I have no idea what any of that means. It sounds very odd to me. But I have had people tell me, you should invest in Bitcoin, to which I was like, First of all, I don't have any money to invest. But if I did have money to invest, I'm not sure that Bitcoin would be it. But I probably should have, because it's like big deal right now.
Yeah. It's I believe last month, it was at its highest.
Do you own Bitcoin?
No, but I was.
Do you own Bitcoin? How do you know then that you two know the price of Bitcoin and you don't?
We just looked it up earlier because we were talking about it. Because I was like, you know, back in 2009 or whatever, when it was first starting to come out, I was a nerd. Not much has changed. But I, you know, back in 2009, I was into everything computer geek, like whatever. And so like this came from that space. And a couple of my buddies were talking about it, and they're like, oh, it's this untrackable currency. And like, you know, you mine for it and you use, you know, whatever. And I'm just remember thinking like, no way that's ever going to take off.
Well,
and back then they, you know, a Bitcoin sold for like 47 cents.
Well, you should have bought one.
And, you know, so we did the math really quick at the current exchange rate. If I put $100 into Bitcoin back then, it would have been how many? 12 million? 6 million? Yeah. A lot of money. A lot of millions. Mm-hmm. Couple millions.
Could you go back in time?
Yeah.
This is what you'd do.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep. And so, and then what we were talking about is like, so it got really popular again in the 2020, you know, COVID era. Along with NFTs, which are non-playable
characters, yeah.
NPC.
Wait.
NFT, non-fungible token. Okay. And that's like
I'm looking art. Over, there's some. There, we have several accounting people in the room right now, and I'm looking at their faces to see if they even know what that is.
Do we know what NFTs? We know?
Kind of, nope, they don't know.
Cryptocurrency? So. We did.
All right.
We know NFT.
What's NFT?
Non-fungible token. And nice. So basically it's like, it was created as a way for artists to sell their art. Is that right? And so you would essentially, it would be a digital way for an artist to sell. And so that piece of art would be a one in, you would own that piece of art digitally. And it was connected to the blockchain as well. And
that sounds
so,
like,
came out of kind of the crypto space. And
by the way, I just would like all of you to know that if you want to own a digital portion of this podcast, we are very happy.
We have an NFT.
All it's going to require is for you to deposit with us a certain amount of actual currency, and then you will own a portion of the podcast.
Yeah. And it's it's not much.
No, well, we continue to mine portions of the podcast.
Yeah.
To find more and more valuable pieces of this podcast. So just so you know, get in early.
Yeah. And now, like, maybe you didn't know what cryptocurrency was or NFTs, and you learned something.
Yeah.
So
the next big thing is the Conversations with Jeff Bucknam podcast.
It's, I mean,
listen, one of these days we're going to sell this thing and you're going to wish you had a piece.
Yeah. Don't be like me and regret not going into Bitcoin.
Right.
You have an opportunity right now.
Okay.
But yeah, people thought that it was going to go away, especially after, you know, the COVID craze of NFTs and crypto. And just recently, within the past couple of months, it has shot. It went from 16,000 per Bitcoin all the way back up to 68.
Tommy, what are the market forces that are causing such a huge accelerant?
Yeah. Could it be?
I don't.
War.
Oh, you think so?
Well, we were talking about, like, who are the people that use this
Bitcoin
untraceable currency?
Mm.
Probably nefarious people.
Possibly. Yeah, wasn't the government of the United States lost like $6 billion a while ago? They couldn't account for it. Something like that.
I don't know. Sounds
that's
right.
That's a question
though.
I'm going to ask. Sounds right. Don't worry. I'm going to hold on to that one.
Yeah. Okay.
When the accountant people come here, I'm going to ask them how that happens, how the government of the United States just loses $6 billion. And it's like, well, we thought we put it over on the table, but we're not sure yet.
Yeah.
Mr. Potter's got it. Mm-hmm. You know what that's a reference to?
Nope.
Yeah. Okay.
Good. I was going to say Harry Potter, but
it's a Wonderful Life.
Okay.
So,
actually, I've seen that movie.
This is really good. Can I ask you one quick question though, before we get into this? And it has nothing to do with Bitcoin.
Tommy, okay. Yeah. I'd love to.
Tommy, as a self-proclaimed Star Wars nerd.
Yeah. Okay.
What are your feelings about Disney's ownership of Star Wars, the Star Wars franchise? Do you feel like they've squandered all that they had given to them in this whole thing? Or like, what are we doing here? Are we excited about it?
Yeah. So I would.
They made Rogue One. That was good.
That was good. Mandalorian, pretty good. There's been a couple of things that they've made that are pretty good. I am of the mind of I kind of. If it's Star Wars, I'll enjoy it to some degree because I just love the universe and the world build.
What if there's no?
I love it.
But what if there's no lightsaber in your Star Wars movie? Is that that's
if we were doing just like a realistic?
I'm
like,
just saying, like, if the lightsaber doesn't show up, are you walking out of that film?
No,
going,
no, that's okay. I like exploring different parts of the lore. That's fine. I wish that the stories that they told were a little bit better and original. The new stories are fine, but the reason that I think most of them are fine is because they copied the original.
Oh, okay.
So if you think about The Force Awakens, like, it's kind of a rip of A New Hope.
Yeah, Tommy,
if you hit the beats of the story.
I haven't really thought about it that much.
You knew that. I know you knew.
Which one's The Force Awakens?
Nothing. Never. It's 7, the new start of the new trilogy.
The girl one.
Yeah, Rey.
Okay, yep.
Skywalker.
The DEI one.
Don't want to give any spoilers away. The DEI one. Oh, no.
Were they?
Disney, yeah.
No, where they all have, like, everybody's there. And you're like, okay.
Yeah.
Which is probably more realistic of the Star Wars world than art, you know?
What I would really wish that Disney would do is I would wish that they would go back, like, before the current, you know, galactic war, go way back, like, to the beginning of the Force.
I thought this was supposed to be a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away.
It is. I would like them to go even further long ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Back to when the dinosaurs were flying those
jets. Yeah. I want to see some real aliens, okay? Not, you know, aliens that look like people.
I thought that's what the Dinobot thing was about.
Like Autobots?
Yeah, yeah.
Like you know, Transformers? Those
dinosaurs and stuff? Yeah. Isn't that what that
those
was?
Those were awesome.
Maybe that's what, that, maybe that's what happened.
You think Star those Wars, universes are...
Maybe Star yeah. Wars became from the Autobots. This is a movie you should make.
This is, yeah. All right, Disney, if you're listening, we just want just a little bit.
Exactly.
Just credit us
yeah, as the one Bitcoin, and you can have that
for
idea.
One Bitcoin, Dinobots meets
all right.
Star Wars is yours. Yeah.
This has been a really enlightening... And that
have
and,
you seen
and
the
that
new
folks
ones?
Was and that folks was your financial minute with Tommy and Jeff.
Yep. And now we're going to get into an actual
financial minute
or a couple minutes that I hope will be very helpful and fun talking about all the things that you guys are going to talk yeah. about. And we've got a couple of guests who are going to come on, and you're going to introduce them when they get here. And we're going to get into that conversation right now. Let's go. May the force be with you.
So I'm sitting across from Darrin Weidman and next to Kelly Altieri. And this is our special edition. A couple months ago, I think it was a few months ago, we ended up doing a financial update thing for our church and stuff like that. Don't worry, this isn't just about like telling you a bunch of numbers and, hey, give more money. It's actually not that at all. We just wanted to keep people up to speed as to how the church is financially doing. One of the things we're trying to do at the church and over the next few years is we'd really believe that we God's called us to be a more generous church. And so this is part of that overall plan of trying to keep in front of ourselves. Darrin actually has lots of really great stories. He was an elder here for, I'll ask you that in a few minutes, a number of years. And Kelly is the controller, which means that she has all power. Right, Kelly?
Yes, I'm all in control.
When you were a little girl, you wanted to be a controller, didn't you?
No, I think I wanted to be a veterinarian when I was a little girl.
So how far away from veterinary work are you doing right now?
About as far as you can get.
Well... You're still dealing with us animals.
True.
You like that one?
That's true.
A good joke. But yeah, we're going to talk a little bit. Kelly's got some updates regarding the finances of the church and what's going on there, and talking a little bit about the kinds of things that we're trying to do moving forward. But Darrin, let's start with you. You have been on the elder board for how many years?
About 5 years.
Well, and then you just stopped being an elder.
Yep.
How many months ago?
About 2 months ago.
Okay. Darrin, I have 1,000 questions about this. I have no idea if you're going to answer my questions.
I'll answer whatever you ask, Jeff.
Well, you were an elder for 2 years before I got here.
Yep.
Because you were one of the elders who jumped onto the elder board at the church's like key crisis time, where the founding church pastor, he was terminated, and you were part of the elder board that came on right after that. Am I right about that?
That's correct.
Like the old elder board, they did the terminating, and then you guys jumped on right
almost
after.
Right away. Yep.
What were you thinking?
It's kind of a loaded question.
Well, no, but you know what I mean. Like somebody comes up to you and it's like, "Hey, you want to be an elder of our church?" Sure. Oh gosh, what an honor. That's so great. Actually, yeah, it's great.
The church is in a complete
a dumpster fire right now, and everything's going sideways. Do you want to do it now?
I was asked. I was actually asked. Twice. I was asked once to be an elder right after that, and I said no. And, well, I said I would prayerfully consider it, but with everything going on, I was like, I didn't pray. So, of course, the Lord was like, ask him again. So I was asked again, and I was telling Christy about it, and I said, I really feel bad because I'm like, I didn't pray about it the first time. It was just kind of like that.
Well, it's because you were kind of probably like, there's no way I'm doing this.
Yes, for sure. And so we prayed about it and really felt like the Lord saying, do you trust me? And I was like.
That would have come as a bit of a shock, that
yeah,
sense.
Totally. I mean, I was like within 3 months, within a couple months span, it was like, you gotta, you know. And we prayed about it and I felt at peace about it. Like, okay, Lord, like, look, there were all these disciples in the Bible when he called them. They didn't all have it together.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, okay, Lord. if you want me to do this, then you're going to have to do what you're only you can do. And so I walked in totally by faith, just to trust the Lord, be obedient, step out, even though we didn't know what we were walking into.
And how what were the early meetings like?
Early meetings were started and ended very early. Like they were late nights. And I was also part of the finance committee for the same amount of time.
Part of the idea of like transparency is getting more people involved. Yep. And so there was the elder board, but then you had a finance committee that was made up of how many elders?
Tim Stoner and myself.
Yeah, just two.
Jeff and Kelly really started the process and trying to interview. And
team of others.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
And people who've got financial background in some regard.
Very much
or,
so.
Or another. And so they came along and you guys started overlooking the whole finance, like the finance committee met once a week?
Yeah. Yes. Starting it was once a week and it was long hours once a week.
Kelly, were you on it?
Yeah.
You
were
on
she's on the finance committee.
Mm-hmm. And so you would meet for that and then you'd also have an elders meeting. Same.
Yep.
And how long were these meetings?
Elder meetings probably went from 6:30 to at the beginning for the first year, probably, I don't know, 2 a.m.
Oh, my word.
And then the finance committee, we would go.
Why are you talking so much, dude?
11.
Did you ever just think to yourself, time to stop talking? Darrin, zip it.
We had a lot of stuff to talk about.
I bet you did.
Totally had a lot to talk about.
Well, and especially the fact that, I mean, all of you guys were relatively new. And so you had that learning curve too, trying to figure out exactly how, it's not just any church, it's how this church functioned. And you got to learn the history and learn exactly what, who said what and how. And man. When you look back at those early days, what are, like, how do you remember it now? Do you remember it as like you'd get a little sick in your stomach or do you feel like, it was a time when the Lord really met you guys or what?
It was totally a time where the Lord really met me. I mean, I feel like being on the finance committee, being on the elder board, definitely strengthened my faith in the Lord, because you have nine guys initially that came in. I think we had 2 years of elder experience amongst all nine total, 2 years. And we went in it just totally hands open, like, Lord, we want to be used by you, like, you lead. And seeing what the Lord did through all that process, it's like, it's great that you can look back and be like, only the Lord could have done that. Like, only the Lord could have done that.
So what did the Lord do? I'm particularly interested in the finance because, you know, that's the fear. A church goes through the kinds of difficulty that they have. And not only that, but their questions were around not just the leadership, but the financial leadership of the church. And that's, you know, I've long believed that churches can do a lot of things. Yep. A lot of leaders can do a lot of things and come out, not unscathed, but come out a little bit better off. But the moment you start with money,
for sure,
that tends to be the death knell, and so there were some questions about the money.
So we found out a lot more when we brought on. I think we had initially we had five congregants join the finance committee, and they were all had a financial background different from different campuses, but they all kind of came in. I feel like at the beginning they all kind of came in like a little on the nervous side, like, well, what questions can we ask? What questions can we not ask? And we're like, you can ask any question you want. We'll tell you everything. Like, they were going to be the conduit for us to be able to build trust in the congregation. And they had a lot of people. When people found out who the congregants were, every time they came to the finance committee, I think each one probably had 15 or 20. I mean, initially, we were just answering a lot of questions that they had. And then we were trying to come up.
Were these people you were interviewing to be a part of the committee, or they were just interviewing like open?
To be part of the finance? Anybody that wanted. Well, I think we were looking at each campus. I think the campus pastors got involved, trying to, who are the financial minds, leader, you know, godly men, women that were leaders in the church that we could use on the finance committee to help. And we didn't know what we didn't know. So when you were asking like what we saw the Lord do, it was amazing. And I've said this, I don't know how many times in the last 5 years, but the fact of all the people that the Lord brought in, each individual person was gifted in a way that we didn't know at the time, but we needed their expertise. Like, Jeff, you couldn't have handpicked, like, knowing what I know now going back, I would have not have changed any of the ones we selected. I feel like the Lord used each individual one and their giftedness to help us through all this stuff. And it was amazing, but it started I think a lot of kudos goes to the Lord for keeping Jeff and Kelly here. I think Kelly Altieri and Jeff Sharda are amazing. They love the Lord. They love his church. And they just wanted to do their job to honor him in everything. Yeah. And so they basically were saying, okay, congregants, like, what do we need to do? How do we build more trust? And how do, so they, besides doing their regular job, they were creating, modifying forms and modifying different procedures. And we had things put in place, but they had a big part in all of this stuff. So they spent a ton of time doing that.
So Kelly, I do have a question. How long have you been at Harvest? Like on the staff?
On staff, I've been 12 years.
Okay. So you went through a lot of this. You're actually part of Harvest at one of it's probably its financial pinnacle.
Mm-hmm.
And then facing this whole thing, my question is why stick around? Do you know what I mean? Like, because it must have obviously be something in your mind that you're thinking to yourself, holy smokes, there's a whole bunch of stuff here that either I wasn't privy to or that has gone completely sideways and I'm out.
Well, in my flesh, I said that.
Yeah.
And I didn't know if I wanted to stay. It was just too much and a sense of, a real sense of betrayal, people that you trusted, it was devastating.
Yeah.
And I wanted to quit, but at the same time, I remember a message from one of the pastors, that if you leave now, you're not going to see the blessing of what's going to happen, what God's going to do through that. And I just remember that being a motivating factor to say, you know, I want to get through this. I want to make it better because I want Harvest to have a better day. And I think I can be a part of that. And just being able to have the perseverance to go through that hard stuff and to really, in the front row, see how God moved through all of that. It's just, it builds your faith and it builds your confidence in the leadership that's here.
So I am particularly interested in specific ways that the Lord encourage you guys as you look back now and you think about maybe different examples or stories or things that the Lord did. The church is in one of its darker moments, obviously. Financially, there's, you know, the church is bleeding people and bleeding finances as well. And the creditors or the people who are, you know, the church owes money to lots and lots of different people for things like power to all sorts of stuff. How did you see the Lord come through in specific ways?
I think to start off with, I think 2019, I mean, right away, and I don't think it was the summertime when we were weeks away from closing the door, like literally going to run out of money. So we were praying that the Lord, to the point of.
When did you find out that you were about to run out of money?
Oh, when Jeff told us.
Jeff show up and say, so was your first response incredulity? I mean, like, no way.
Yeah. Because you have to understand that the attendance was going down pretty quickly. There's kind of chaos in what's going on with the church. And I'm sure the congregants are all like, what's going on? Like, we used to trust these leaders and now this all happened. Like, what's going on?
Right.
Trust
you these guys. You're giving, of course you would. Or so people that's withhold. The way that people would think about it. I'm not sure yet whether or not that, you know, the people who are in charge of it are.
At one point in time, we talked about, do we file for bankruptcy? Like, we had to explore every option we had. Do we sell all the campuses? Like, initially, it was like, we got to that point where we're like, nothing's off the table. What do you guys have? And so as a group, finance committee group, they all knitted together. I feel like as much as I miss the elder board, I miss the finance committee, same, just because of the relationships you build. And when you get to see the Lord meet the needs of, like, in 2 weeks, we're going to absolutely run out of money. And we walked through. And
so why didn't you run out of money in 2 weeks? What happened?
The Lord provided.
He provided.
How did he provide?
we met it. And so basically, I think Jeff had his run rate, his cash on hand or whatever, was basically, we're going to run around in 2 weeks. And then a week later, we're going to run out in 3 weeks. And then a week, like the Lord never all of a sudden said, hey, we'll set you up for the next 2 or 3 years. It was all, we were dependent month and month. And then we got a little bit more, a little bit more. But we got to see that as attendance was going down, as giving was actually going down, and they were managing their expenses for the church fantastically, the Lord just provided enough that we all knew it was him. Like, there's nothing we can do, right?
Right. And we managed the relationships with the vendors.
Yep,
the banks. And we were able to push things out as far as we could, mm-hmm. and we managed our expenses. We cut where we could. And
the hard part is that there are some things that are uncuttable when you own property,
right?
You have to pay for the property pieces, like mm-hmm. the upkeep, that kind of, well, I say upkeep, I mean like the heat and the,
electricity
and even mowing. Basic upkeep that, or the place gets infested with rats and stuff.
Yeah, for sure.
So there are some things that are just have to be paid for. And since you had so many facilities, that would have been a particular challenge.
Yep.
But so, the Lord provided for all of that. We were not late. Mm-hmm. We weren't delinquent.
Nope.
In any mortgage payments. We made every single mortgage payment. And the vendors, we have good relationships with our vendors. Whatever we could push out a couple weeks, we would.
Did you find them understanding?
Yes, absolutely. We had a ton of grace from our vendors.
Yep.
It's really cool. That's great to hear, right?
And a ton of grace from, the people that were staying. I mean, we had to deal with a lot of, phone calls and people saying, you got to stop my giving. You guys are crooks and have to try to handle those in a gracious manner.
Are you a crook?
I am
Kelly.
Not a crook.
All right, well.
I think that's what Nixon said, too,
he did.
Right?
I am not a crook. I'm not a crook.
So, but.
That's hard, though, to hear. I mean, it's hard to hear that because, people's frustration with an organization and with people who, their frustration with something they can't put a face to necessarily. So they end up thinking anybody involved with the organization must be complicit with all of that. And so you're a crook, or the whole thing is crooked, where you're like, I actually been trying to faithfully serve as much as we possibly could for all this time. Mm. And there were aspects of these things that we didn't 100% know about. And so now that we do, I used to say the best time to ever fly on an airplane was September 12th, 2001. But that's because there's no way, they're as safe as they're ever going to be right at that point.
Yep.
And similarly, sometimes the best time to be giving and knowing the money is going to be used about as wisely as it could possibly be is after something really goes haywire, is because the people who are coming in afterwards are trying to make sure that the errors that were made ahead of time are absolutely not. And they become quite vigilant, in fact, about those sorts of things. How else, Darrin, did the Lord provide?
Well, I just look at the debt. I mean, I think of at its peak, I think we were at $70 million. In debt.
And when was that?
Gosh, that was been...
Early 2000s.
Yep.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah. It was like right around the time that we built Elgin, so about 2003. Yep.
The church, though, back at that particular time, though, if you looked at like the balance sheets, we're getting out of my depth when we start using the words for the sheets and things. You already used the word run something, and I was like, okay.
Run rate.
There you go, the run rate. I'm going to throw that in a little bit later, run rate, and then we're going to see if I did it the right way.
All right.
See, now I forgot what I was going to say.
You were saying about the $70 million.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so $70 million. That number sounds outrageous right now, but the church at that point had, like, the budget was like, what, $50 million, $40, $50 million? So it's not, usually people say, about 1.5 times of your budget is kind of what you go into debt. So it was, I mean, it's a lot of money, but it wasn't for the church the size it was at that time and the ministries that were going on. It's actually not that crazy.
Yeah. And I would say from the time we started until even now, over the last 5 years, I mean, we've reduced the debt by like $14 million. And that's with a fourth of what they had in 2019.
Yeah.
So if you look, it's like God's math doesn't make sense. And it's not like we sold everything. It's just the Lord has provided. We have, and you've said this many times, Jeff, but the people at Harvest, they want to see what the Lord's going to do. And we have generous givers at the church. Yeah. And we had faithful givers in the church. And I feel like we've spent probably the first 2 years just meeting with people, building back the trust in the church, showing all the books, like, here, if you want to come in, talk to us. Like, you know, no one's hiding anything. We want to show you everything. Like, just tell us what you need. And but building back the trust in the relationship. And so that's been awesome. We got to see it firsthand.
Yeah. We were able to, through the Lord's provision, plant the Niles campus as an independent church.
How did that come about? I mean, obviously things were going a little bit sideways. And so as a result, there was a feeling. I think that was always kind of the plan, though, for Niles to be on its own.
That was always something that was initially what they've always talked about, that was supposed to be on its own.
Yeah.
And this was just a perfect timing. We talked about it and prayed about it and, you know, felt like, okay, they were promised this, even though it would hurt us financially by doing that, because you've got the givers at Niles and the tithing. But we felt like, this is another step by faith, Lord. We're going to do what's right. You know, we promised them this. We're going to honor that. And we graciously did that, and they have been flourishing ever since, and the Lord has continued to provide for us. So it's been great.
Yes. So that we were able to reduce debt there.
Mm-hmm.
And right when all of this stuff happened in 2018, we had kicked off a capital campaign called Closer, and we had collected funds and up to that point, and we used almost $3 million of the funds that we had collected there to pay down debt. Mm-hmm. So from 2018 to 2023, we've paid down 33% of our debt.
That's a lot.
Isn't that awesome?
It is. No, I mean, what is that? What did you say, 2018 to 23?
Yeah, 5 years.
5 years. My goodness. That's fantastic.
33%. And so our current balance is just under $29
million. Which sounds an outrageous amount.
It's still an outrageous amount.
Like, well, less than half of what was the biggest, that was the number at the very get-go.
But from where we were at, $29 million, I mean, I'm looking back, and it's like, oh my gosh, Lord, you've done all that. Like, it's crazy.
Right. And we will be doing, we're going to be doing a capital campaign later in the year, too, to not just address the debt, but other things we want to focus on going forward, what the church is going to look like, mm-hmm. and a lot of things regarding missions and church planting and stuff that was really near and dear to Harvest Heart for lots and lots of years. And so in some ways, Harvest Renewal is genuinely a going back to the, in some cases, the early days of Harvest and the kinds of things that were really mattered to this church, right? Mm. And I'm quite confident that people at the church are going to be excited about all of that, because we were all excited about it at the very get-go. We're still excited about it. It's just sometimes you go down a cul-de-sac and come back. So we're hoping to get back to the main road here in the next little while. And so we'll see how that all works out. Kelly, how much money does a church like us, if you were going to carry a debt, this is just me asking, how much money would be normal for a church our size to carry? Like, a lot of churches carry debt.
Right. Our auditors have said, like you said earlier, about 1.2.
Yeah.
Or 1.5.
And for us, that would be about $18-19 million, something like that?
Yeah, 20.
Yeah. Not that, by the way, anybody wants to be in debt $19 to $20 million. I have no desire for that at all. But it is not uncommon for churches to have some kind of debt that they're trying to pay off because of the cost of facilities and things like that.
Right. But the really cool thing about one of the other ways that God provided during this past 5 years is our relationship with Christian Financial Resources.
Who are they?
CFI.
They're a not-for-profit ministry based in Florida, and they help churches and other Christian-based ministries to fund, a.k.a. loan, the ministries, the money that they need in order to do their ministries well. And so they came alongside us.
They're not a bank.
They're not a bank.
Mm-hmm. No.
And they use funds that are invested with them from other Christians, individuals, mm-hmm. and ministries that invest their money there and get an interest rate return. And then they use those funds to fund more ministry.
So there, it's not a money making gig.
Correct.
It's a money. All the money that is made off of the interest goes right back into the loans that go to all these other churches and Christian ministries.
Right. And so now the vast majority of our $29 million, about mm-hmm. $23 million of it, is with CFR. And so the interest that we're paying them is going to fuel more ministry.
Yeah. Which is a really cool, I mean, in this odd way, it is like giving to other churches, in the sense that you're giving money that those churches will be able to use to build a building, say, in downtown Chicago or somewhere. I mean, they do it all over the country,
right?
All over the place. And I've said this before to people, when I lived in Canada, this is one of the biggest challenges that churches had there, because property was so expensive. It was very difficult for churches to get any buildings. So if you were going to plant a church, which of course is what, the only way you're going to replace the churches that were closing all across Canada. In fact, it was becoming the case where lots of churches would close and sell their property to like a housing development or whatever. And we always felt really sick about that, because we were like, first of all, you're not going to get the zoning back because none of the cities are excited about church being there.
Right.
You know, but across Canada, trying to get money or trying to get buildings was a big deal, but nobody had the kind of like financial power to be able to lay out the money for the buildings. And so we were always trying to figure out, there's surely got to be a way for, you know, business people and others to form some sort of organization that would be able to loan money to, you know, get a decent return and then use that money. And I had no idea about CFR at the time. Mm. And then moved here and all of a sudden met these guys, and I was like, wait, I remember sitting in the room with them. Kelly, you might've been there. And I was like, you guys do the stuff we've been trying to do for all these years.
Oh, the timing of bringing them on was from the Lord too. Like, we were looking for someone like that. And I can't remember did Jeff run across them? Sharda?
Sharda had worked with them back in 2018 when we were looking for someone to do some refinancing.
Yeah.
And so it didn't work out at that point in time. But then in, 2022... it was the Lord's timing. Mm.
It's also been interesting too, like the lenders from that the church has had in the past there were some fractious relationships with them, often because Harvest didn't act in the nicest ways, have actually been relatively kind over the last while, because they really do, some of a lot of them Christian groups and others who see that the church is trying to recover, and so they're financially trying to give as much space and help. I mean, as somebody coming in from the outside and walking in, I've been encouraged. It's been one of the things I've been most encouraged by in terms of the Christian community, is how willing they are to show grace. And even though in some cases they've been deeply wronged in the past, but how willing they've been shown, willing they are to show grace and move forward. And when they see that there's a renewal project in the way, they're like, sweet. Mm-hmm. Like, this is why we get involved in ministry. And even though they've been, they had real challenges in the past with, say, Harvest, the way they treat us is not that way. It's actually quite friendly. At least that's in my experience. Shelley, you don't say anything different if that's not the case, because you're probably behind the scenes.
No, you're exactly right. And the other financial institution that we have a loan with, we didn't have a good relationship with back 5 years ago. And last year, they agreed to extend our loan terms that are favorable.
Mm-hmm. Without like big fights or anything. It wasn't like they want to help.
Right.
They want to see the church flourish. They want to see,
it's things like this when you're just saying, like, how do you like know like what the Lord's been doing? It's like all of this stuff where you're thinking they shouldn't act this way. They shouldn't respond this way, but they did.
Well, normal banks wouldn't. I don't, Correct. Well, maybe they would. I don't know.
Yeah,
Wouldn't expect it is a sign of Christian charity and brother and sisterhood when you see them, because money's where, really, quite honestly, money's where the rubber meets the road for a lot of people. You can usually tell people's Christian commitments by how they're using their money. And so when you see these organizations that are explicitly Christian and they're involved in this financial stuff and they're willing to work together with a church like ours. It's, I don't know. I get very encouraged by it. It gives me hope. There's so many bad things going on in the world and so many ways that Christians treat each other poorly, but this is not one of them. This is a place where the Christians are treating each other quite well, thank you. And Harvest is here today, I think, in large part because of the charity and grace that those people have shown to the church.
Mm-hmm.
It came down, though, to like in the last minutes, from what I understand, that the church was going to go under, but the Lord provided some finance in the last minute. Am I wrong about that? I'm looking at you, Darrin, just for the years gone by. No,
I think
I can't remember. There was some sale of some rights to airtime on TBN or these sorts of things that all just kind of came through at the last minute.
That was very early on in 2019.
Okay.
There was a whole backstory there, but we did, receive some significant funds for the unused airtime in a sale to TBN. And we had that in our bank account, and that's what we were using through 2019 to try to
pay people,
make ends meet.
Yeah.
But the bank had put some restrictions on our accessing that money.
Yeah.
That was part of the problem with, things looking like we've only got a couple weeks left. But yet, one of the things that came up at the last minute was that they agreed to allow us to use those funds to pay mortgage.
Yeah, but stuff like that, you know, just in the nick of time.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, there were so many things that we were looking at in that fall of 2019 to try to find resources. You know, no rock was
unturned.
And ultimately it came down to the Lord providing for sure, but he provided through his people and the giving at the end of the year that year was off the charts.
Yeah.
And at that time people were still in that mode of trying to figure it out for themselves. Like, who do I believe? What's real? What's not? And, through all of that, at the end of the year and every year
since then, we've always met.
Like, God just provides exactly what he feels we need.
It's crazy too. I mean, how specific it is. Even the years that I've been here at the end of the year on three successive occasions. And so on three occasions, it's always been, I mean, the Lord's provided a little bit extra when we were trying to do some get leadership development stuff off the ground. And so he provided extra so we could see that.
Yep.
And then the following year we needed, I can't remember the amount, but we got exactly the amount that was needed. It was like $185,000 or something.
Weren't we short at the end of the year? And then there was a check that was
in the mail
that was sent somewhere else that got lost. But so we were short a little bit, and then they found the check like somewhere in January.
Well, what had happened was the person that sent it was out of state. They sent it from out of state, but it didn't arrive until after we had announced our total. And then it came in a couple days, after that Sunday. And it's like, well, the Lord knew that what was coming.
He knew it was already there. But stuff like that. And I mean, delightful to see how. So that's, I think that's my big question. We sometimes in our lives, I know this personally, when I think about the way the Lord has interacted with me over my life, I am a guy who's like, God, why can't it just be, riding with the wind? Mm-hmm. Why can't I just have the, so that it's not as hard. But then I also know that it's in those times that I've learned a lot about God and learned a lot about his character in ways that I know I wouldn't have otherwise. So what have you learned? Had this never happened, what would you be missing out on in terms of your learning about the character of God that you've gained by going through all of it and seeing it all happen?
Oh gosh, I'm thinking for me, I kind of equate that to like when I went through cancer back in 93, 94 to this, like when you're dependent on him for everything and then the times that you have enough and you're content, and sometimes, Satan has a good way of just kind of like, you just kind of feel content with where you're at and you get complacent, and all of a sudden I've always found closest to the Lord whenever I've been struggling with things. When I was going through cancer is when I really met him. And then all of a sudden I go through a season and, you know, prosperity at work. And all of a sudden it's like you start thinking, wow, I did pretty good. And it's really not about me. But you start thinking that. That's why money is such a dangerous thing. I've told Christy, I've talked to some friends of mine, I'm thinking, well, I feel like I tithe. I feel like I have a generous heart. Why wouldn't the Lord want to give me more money so I can be more generous? And one of my buddies just said to me, like, you know, it's the love of money. Maybe the Lord knows that, hey, if I gave you that much, I know what you would do with that. And I don't, that's not good. So it's kind of like one of those things where I trust the Lord and everything. Or why did I need to get a sales job when I thought I had it and I didn't get it? Instead of getting upset, he's like, well, maybe the Lord knew that that was going to be a time suck for you and you were going to spend all your time or you lose money on the job. And he knew that and he was protecting you. Things you just know. So you praise him in the good, you praise him in the bad. At the end of the day, he knows what's best. He's going to be teaching me through it. But I find I draw closer to him when I'm going through difficult times. And I like being totally on my knees, dependent on the Lord for that stuff.
Well, there's not a lot of temptation to other idols in those moments.
No, not at all.
Like, cause you just know that they don't work out and you're like, well, this is kind of me and the Lord here.
Yep.
You know, when you think about all this stuff, and I want you to answer the same question if that's okay, Kelly, in just a second, but sure. Like when you think about so much of the discussion about money, my mind immediately goes back to the way that God initiated his care for the people of Israel by providing manna in the wilderness, right? Mm-hmm. You're not supposed to take too much.
Daily.
Yep. And you have to show up every day, mm-hmm. You know, which of course was hard for them. But we pray, give us a day our daily bread. And that's supposed to be a remembrance to that story. To say, well, actually, the Lord actually wants us to rely on him every moment and every day. And the things that happen around us are happening so that we can interact with him, so that our distance from him relationally can never get too great. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And I tend to think that the reasons that the things that are happening, let's happen to Harvest or happen other places, is because the Lord wants to have, he actually wants to have a closer relationship with us and wants to reveal to us certain aspects of his character that we wouldn't be able to see otherwise. So what have you seen in that regard, Kelly? When you look back, what it's been, 5, 7 years, whatever it is, and you think, okay.
There's been a few things that I've learned, I guess. And number one is idols. And the idols that I had in my own heart had to get broken and just laid prostrate before the Lord and just understand that he is the author of everything, and everything that we went through was not a surprise to him, and it was for our good. So remembering that no matter how hard it was back then and how much I wanted to give up, it was for my good, and I can see that on this side of it. And it's for the good of Harvest and for his kingdom. What we went through. And the other thing that it taught me was the utter dependence that we truly do have on him. And being able to be with the finance committee in prayer and just watching him do what only he can do, because we were at the end of our... Mm-hmm. Selves.
Yep.
You know, we had all of these great ideas, and yet the way that he provided again and again and again just showed how utterly dependent we are on him.
I've actually never been anywhere where my ideas are so infrequently come to fruition as I have at Harvest. I used to think I had good ideas. And then you come to Harvest, and you know, oh, here's an idea, and it doesn't work out. At all. You go down all of these different, like I use the language of cul-de-sacs. I mean, I've seen the whole neighborhood, man. And after a while, you just kind of hold your hands up and say, you know, Lord, you're wise and I'm not. And, you know, try as I might, if the Lord doesn't build the house, we labor in vain. I think we say those words, but we don't actually really believe them. Americans, and so we think we can create all the things and we can control all of the outcomes, but this whole thing, my time at Harvest, you know, 3 years, but and seeing the history, just even recent history of Harvest has taught me an awful lot about the control of God and how our job often is to wait on Him. Mm-hmm. And to remain faithful in the meantime, the best we possibly can, and how bad I am at that, and how much I desperately, I do want to be better at it, but how irritated I am in the meantime. I'm like, not very different than the people of Israel.
Yeah, for sure. Same.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And the other thing I just remember in 2019, as a lot of this stuff was unfolding, saying to Jeff Sharda, this is accounting lingo, but I'm like, we're a going concern. And that means in accounting lingo, you're not going to survive the year. And the auditors are going to say, give us an opinion that we're a going concern. How do we get beyond a year? How do we get a clean opinion in what we were doing? And it was just like devastating. It's like, I don't see a way out here. But yet there was, and it was God.
Yeah, he's got little passageways that we don't know a lot about.
Yeah,
it's hard.
So
to
we
trust
were able to have. I mean, we were able to have a clean opinion. You know, we had to disclose everything that we were doing. You know, all of the subsequent events and everything. But at the end of the day, we had enough to keep our doors open for another year.
Yeah, and listen, there's no look. God's world is not going to be devastated by no Harvest Bible Chapel. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not right. That Harvest Bible Chapel has some special importance in God's economy. But I do think God loves a renewal story. And I think that that's his heart. I think part of Harvest's story just in the last number of years is that, you know, if you get into the book of Revelation, there's a letters to the churches that the Lord can remove a lampstand, you know, and Harvest is an interesting situation because I think you felt like you got on the precipice of that lampstand being removed and that not being a church. And I think though the Lord's like, all right, let's put it back and see where we can go from here with a church that's been through the ringer and is able to come back to full devotion in me. And I hope that that's what Harvest is and will be in the days ahead. We'll be a church with full devotion in Jesus. I do know, I was in a phone call the other day and one of the guys said, okay, so you got here, we should make plans about this. And what if, well, okay, we're going to make this plan. And what if this plan doesn't come out? How are we going to deal with that? My response was, well, sometimes you plan to go in this city or that city, you make some money. But if the Lord wills, and I think he was a little, not, he wasn't massively put off. He laughed, but I thought to myself how different that is than the way that I would answer a question. You know, 10 years ago, I would have probably been a lot more sure. Well, we'll have this 5-point plan to tell people that, you know, whereas now I'm like, well, sometimes you live with the providence of God. We always live in the providence of God. And, you know, he knows best, as hard as that is to take. Kelly, I would be interested to find out some of the recent numbers for the church and kind of where we are. Like, we're going to put your little stethoscope on the old church's financial heart. What's going on?
Well, through April, we're, our giving is down about $300,000 from what we were projecting. Mm-hmm. And just as a reminder, the budget that we set for this year, we were asking the Lord for an increase of 6% in our giving over last year, mm-hmm. in order to fund all of the ministry that we have planned.
Yeah.
And so we're a little short of that right now, but our expenses we're managing in order to minimize the impact of that shortage.
That is one thing that we have been planning on doing throughout the year is, you know, every quarter we're kind of working quarter to quarter. And if what the Lord provides, we're kind of trying to keep in line with the best we can at that time. And so I think we're kind of within striking distance. I think our costs are still, there's still a gap between the money we have in and the amount of money we spent, but it's not huge.
Right. Through April, as of right now, we're still working on April, but it's about $70,000.
Yeah.
That gap.
Yeah.
So 300,000, but really it's a gap of about 70,000. And we have, to the best of our abilities, plans to try to close that gap.
Yeah.
And ask the Lord for more provision.
Yeah. Well, we're trusting the Lord to see how it is that he's going to take care of that. We do, I mean, the 6%, you know, the economy and all that kind of thing comes into all of this, but we do still believe that the 6% was something that the Lord, we were spending the money on things that were important, sometimes updating some salaries for people on our, in our church and some other areas. We weren't spending much money at all on ministry. Mm-mm. And so we were like, well, that's not right. So we did go in faith, trust that the Lord was going to provide for it. And we still believe that he will. I will going to tell you my theological thought though. Okay. Ready?
Sure.
Are you ready, Darrin?
I'm ready.
Well, if you don't like that, I don't care if you don't like this at all. I was teaching a class last night, and it was about the means of grace. Do you guys know that's a phrase that's used sometimes in Roman Catholic circles to talk about how it is that you, so the sacraments are called means of grace, ways for you to get grace back into your life. And so for them, the sacraments are a way for you to get what they call justifying grace, meaning that, you know, you get saved and then you drop below the line of salvation. And if you die and you have a gap, you go to purgatory and you have to work it off, right? But the sacraments are a way on this side of your death to work that off, right? Okay. That's not what we believe. Mm-hmm. Darrin, don't freak out. That's not what we believe. As Protestants, though, we recognize, okay, there are means of sanctifying grace, meaning that, okay, so there are means for us to know God better. There are means for us to serve God more and receive from him a greater experience, say, of the Holy Spirit or whatever it is. And so those means of grace are things like, certainly the Word of God is one of them, but baptism and the Lord's Supper. But we go down a big list, and one of the ones that we were talking about last night in my class was the grace of giving. Mm. Because essentially here's what giving does for you. God has basically said, look, I want you to follow me all the rest of your days of your life and finish the race that you've begun. If you don't finish the race that you've begun, it actually proves that you're not mine. Okay. So that's a doctrinal mm-hmm. truth. So he said, look, let me give you some means by which you can finish the race. And I think giving is one of those key means, because what it does is I get the opportunity to every month, every week, every whatever, say that money is not my God. And I'm going to trust the Lord for my daily bread. And I'm going to do it in a sacrificial way by handing this money, first fruits, whatever. I'm going to hand this money over to the Lord as the first act that I'm doing. And I know that the month might come to an end and I might need that, but I'm going to trust that the Lord's going to provide for me whatever it is that he thinks I need at the end of the month anyway, but it's his first. I'm going to take care of all of that first. And it's my act of almost, you know, rebellion against the idolatry and say, I trust you, Lord. So here's my act of worship. It's painful at times. You see the money go out of your bank account. You wonder whether or not it's going to be able to take care of. And then you give it to the Lord. And that severs me to some degree from thinking the money's going to take care of me. And instead, now I say, well, the Lord's going to take care of me. And he might do it through money. He might do it other ways. Might through my brothers and sisters, you know, coming alongside of me. And maybe they might not give me money, but they might give me support in some way that I thought was going to be taken care of through the money or whatever. So for me, I actually think giving becomes this really cool opportunity for us to declare our allegiances to the Lord and to, by doing it regularly, finish the race of faith committed to Christ. Yeah, come on, Darrin.
I'm with you.
You've experienced this.
Yeah, I'm with you. When Christy and I, early in our marriage, so we're 25 years at Harvest this year, and I remember like in our first year, we had just gotten married, and my tithing was more like whatever I had in my wallet. And if somebody was looking at me, it'd probably be a little bit more. You know, it was one of those things, sadly to say, but that's how it was.
Is that still the case? Because if that's the case, I'm just going to walk around behind you.
You're just going to stare at me the whole time. So what ended up happening was, I can't remember if it was a small group of a message I heard, but I'm like, step up by faith. I'm like, we're going to tithe. I'm going to write a check, and we're giving it at the end of the month. And I looked at my checkbook and I was like, Chris, it's going to bounce. And we went through and so I'm straight commission. So I get my commission on the 30th but I know what I'm going to get on the 30th by like the 8th of that month because from the previous month. So I knew at that point in time, I didn't cover my draw. So I knew what I was getting and my tithe check would have bounced. And we waited and I was about a week beforehand. I'm like, told Kristen, like, it's going to bounce. But I'm like, Lord, I'm just going to trust you. I'm going to submit it. You know, the count. Like within a couple days of that, I ended up getting a what we call a spiff check, which is a kickback from manufacturers when I sell their product. They get just covered it. So the next month, I said,
it was a coincidence, though, you know,
totally coincidence. So I'm thinking, I'm gonna try that again. I'm like that, but it was cool, like seeing the Lord provide at the last second. We did it again. It was gonna bounce. The Lord provided just enough, not like overabundant, kind of like our budget at the end of the year. He provides enough. He doesn't give us $6 million over. It's provides enough. And then there was a situation that arose that, and I think it was my second year of BOS and, you know, wasn't making a ton of money and my uncle got sick. And so my dad was paying his medical bills and I felt convicted. Like you should help your uncle, like, cause I was not a nice kid and my nice nephew and I didn't treat him well. And so I called my dad and said, hey, I want to help out. So he had these various medical bills and I just said, you know, just grab one. And so he grabbed one. It was like, whatever, $900. And I'm like, okay, Lord, I feel like you have, you know, when the Lord's kind of weighing it on, you're like, okay, I'm just going to be obedient. And I did it, forgot about it. It was great. Helped out. My dad was thankful. My uncle found out and he was super thankful. So he and I got to work out some differences that we had, which was sweet. And then all of a sudden, I can't remember the period of time after that, within a couple months, Christy gets a check from the IRS.
Your wife.
Christy, my wife. Yep. And she got a check from the IRS for Christy Hill for within, I don't know, $13 of exactly what that medical bill was. And I knew when I got that the Lord just wanted to remind you, like, I gotcha. Like,
so all of these things are supposed to build your faith. And by faith, meaning that I don't need the idols. No. I need the Lord Jesus. And so money's not the answer for me. Yep. Jesus is the answer for me. Yep. He's got lots of money. And that he will give me what it is that he thinks I need. Mm-hmm. And that, to be honest with you, that freedom and that joy, is something we want for everyone. So I try to tell people, and I will say it as much as I can, that guy came to me one time when I was a pastor. He said, you're just one of those pastors. You just want everyone's money. You just want my money. And I said, oh, I want your money, all right, but not for me. Mm. I want it for you. And that's what I feel like. I want it for you. The church is going to be taken care of, clearly. The Lord's going to take care of his church. But the question is, are you going to finish the race? And the way you're going to finish the race is by, you know, weeding out some of the idols in your life. And God's given us means to do that through giving.
And it's their benefit.
And it's for your benefit. It is for your benefit. Yep. God, the Lord our God is a more valuable thing than anything in the universe, right? Mm-hmm. Is treasure hidden in a field. You should sell everything you've got by that field.
Yep.
So, we are trying to convince people of that. The church should probably never have any need for money because we're all so jealous to have more and more of God and see him reveal himself in our lives that the finances of a local church aren't an issue. I really want to thank you guys for coming along and sitting here and listening to me preach at you. I should do this more often. You guys should just sit here and I can tell you stuff.
We'll listen.
Yeah, I wouldn't have to show up on the weekends at all. It'd be amazing. I'm kidding. I would like to show up on the weekend. Darrin, I want to tell you, thank God for you and thank God for your willingness to serve Jesus in the church's hour of need.
Well, thank you.
Right? Like if you think about the way that, you know, when Paul is riding on his horse or whatever, and he's about to go and kill all the Christians or drag them off, and Jesus interrupts him and says, why are you persecuting me? He equates himself with the church. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Which means, of course, that those who protect the church of Jesus are actually serving Jesus in a very unique, clear way. So, I don't know. I have a lot of time for people who have been willing to give a lot of themselves to serve Jesus in the local church and stand up for the bride. So, you're one of those guys, right? Sword in your hand. shotgun in your belt, but you got lots of bruises from it. And I just, I think I speak for lots and lots of people and tell you thank you so much for your willingness to do it. I'd say the same of you, Kelly, different role, but I think you you didn't have to stick around, but you did. And I pray that your hope when you did stick around to see God move in ways that maybe you hadn't seen would continue in the days ahead, so that you will be able to say, there's a lot of things that I've experienced in my life, but the one thing I know is that God is faithful to his church.
Yep. Amen.
All right. Well, the rest of you, will talk to you next time. Thanks for joining us on the special broadcast. And take care.